Graham, for example, was clearly the movements were, I don't want to use the wrong word here, but there was weight to her movement, which from the very beginning, even in the Cornish school, when I was simply working at those strange exercises, something about the weight of them, I couldn't think of any other word. Whereas if someone else took that movement without having seen her, would have perhaps made something which was far lighter. But I found that part of her work, when particularly watching her, frankly, remarkable. The way she would move an arm and that beautiful solo frontier where the leg comes up to the side that way, the weight with which it got there, got up high, but it wasn't just a high kick, it was this motion through space in a certain amount of time that had a kind of shape and weight to it. And that was, I think, very much part of her, all her work, probably.
I love taking Merce's classes, and I never aspired to be in the company because I didn't look like anybody in that company. And one day, Merce said, "Can we have dinner?" And we went to a little Italian restaurant, I think, on 16th Street, down a couple of stairs. And we had Italian food, and he said, "I think I'd like you to dance with us." And it was like a movie. I mean, I just kind of floated home. And that was that. And I said goodbye to Martha Graham. I didn't actually say goodbye to Martha Graham. I just didn't show up anymore.
Merce's partnering can be very serene and careful, or it can be just wild, like in Scramble. It seems to be one or the other. He likes the idea of risk and unusual partnering, like changing levels suddenly, for instance, or sudden drops, and it's all a matter of timing.
I think Merce took a lot from Graham, partly in what he rejected from it, and partly in what he retained from it, I think, in the way he personally performed. There was always a great theatricality about Merce's own dancing, which he did not actively discourage in us, in the company, but he certainly didn't encourage it, and he certainly didn't give us the kinds of clues that would take us there. He encouraged clarity. Clarity of the intention of the movement. And that usually kept us busy enough that we couldn't impose other junk on it, extraneous stuff on it.
One's own imagination makes Merce's stories dramatic because he creates these beautiful masterpieces that can have, he doesn't feed a story to you. They're not program notes about what to think, and they're derived from this or that or anything like that, no background. The audience is free, and so are the dancers, to look at these pieces and make up stories if they want. Or the audience can just say, hey, this is a pure movement piece. It's like balancing, just really appreciating the lines and the technical ability of the dancers.
In those days, what I was familiar with was narrative modern dance. It was the late 50s, early 60s. And that's what it was. So I was seeing in Merce's work a narrative that came from my own imagination. But what I was seeing in front of me was pure movement, quintessential movement that was so clear in every aspect that there was no doubt about what the intention of the movement was. The movement was all intention, kinetic intention, and not emotional intention or expression. So that left us free to impose our own ideas about what it meant. So I was able to apprehend it both as my own narrative, which I understood to be my own narrative, and as pure movement expression, movement as medium.
I think about movement as a possibility to begin with for humans to do. And then sort of an attempt to stay on the alert for movement that's not familiar to me, so I have to find a way to show it, explore it, in order to make it useful for the dancers.
Merce Cunningham's company did Crises, and I was transfixed. I had never seen anything that spoke to me that loudly that was dance. Because I had done tap dancing and, you know, all that. But suddenly this was something, this was a movement expression that was cataclysmic. And I decided, okay, because I'd been on the fence about becoming a dancer, maybe, or becoming an architect, make a living. And at that point, I think I realized that it was more than a desire, it was a need for me to do this. Now I read Merce's work as being quintessential dance. It is the essence of dance. It is motion as the medium, which is why it's always timeless. It doesn't date. It doesn't require any additional stuff, you know, and which is why it also lends itself to being part of the kind of collaboration that it's involved in with a, you know, sound collaboration and visual and motion. Those elements come together and present for the audience a collage image, which again they can still take away from what they like. And the movement certainly works without the other elements. And very often the other elements work without the movement, which is more of more. Sometimes you can experience all of them separately with equal value because they all have their own integrity, which is what makes that kind of collaboration that Merce and John set up so fulfilling artistically, because the composer doesn't have to fit the music to the dance, and the choreographer doesn't have to stretch the dance to fit the music. There's always that tension. Rainforest is a piece that has a lot of emotional resonance that's very close to the surface. I related entirely to him because he related to us kinetically. When he passed away, I was happy for him, because it seemed so cruel for him to be trapped in that body that didn't function, when that was his soul being able to move. And the way he overcame that was heroic.
Well, you know, dancing is a physical act that you deal with daily. And it's quite true, when you get older, certain things you can't do the way you did. But there are other ways to think then. And rather than not think at all, or not try at all, in one sense, from my point of view, it's better to try.
You have enough ego to dare to present yourself for inspection by an audience. And yet, there is an implicit awareness that what dancing is considered for most people has nothing to do with what you can do. And yet, you're willing to show your own ability, lack of ability, with intention that makes it integrous. So the tricky part is not trying to do things that you're not capable of doing at all, and finding a way to do movement that is appropriate and comfortable to your physicality. And that's really easier said than done.
Suddenly there's a company of three people or eight people or 60 people, I don't think it matters, it's only in proportion, then you have to consider all of those people in all the ways. The fact that they are people, the fact that they must somehow get from day to day, you know, and have some place to sleep and something to eat and all of that. And all of that has to be taken into consideration, as well as the fact that you are now not only responsible for making a dance for yourself, but for these other dancers too, and that implies something about clothing, covering them up some way, something about music, however you think of that, and all of that gets more involves more funds, one way or another. But you do it.
No,
if you find a way to function, or you quit, of course. And if you're interested in continuing, which is what I always thought about, I was interested in dancing, not just by myself, I was interested in working and dancing with other people. So you find a way to continue. And it may not be entirely satisfactory in every way. I never thought that's what it's about. I think the real thing is the fact that you continue. That you keep on doing things, because it isn't about the money or not having money or anything like that. It's about making something. And it gets caught in all this business about when the government comes at you for this or the landlord comes at you for that or whatever. You get sort of caught in those things, but that's not really what it's about.